Hello and welcome to The Vote here at Latest TV. My name is Mike Mendoza, and today's special guest is Mr. Bill Murray. Not the actor.
Unfortunately,
do you get confused? People confuse you at times.
Do you know, I do a radio thing on BBC. I shouldn't say it, but BBC Radio Sussex in Surrey. And there's a gentleman last week who specialises in the film Groundhog Day. And he's written talks and theories and thesis on the film. And he came in to talk about Bill Murray as I was doing my movie roundup. And ironically, it was we got talking. I've just had an email from this morning to say he'd love to get in touch because he's doing a Bill. He does a thing on Bill Murray and how Groundhog Day is still the most important film he ever made.
But you're also a Murray Media.
Murray Media is my company, and which we've run for since the 1800s.
I see, you've been a long time now. I remember you when you were young.
I was never young. I was always just jaded. But yes, Murray Media, 16 years.
But you've been involved with so many things around the city over the last God knows how many years, as you were saying there, including The Wheel, of course.
Yeah, The Wheel is one of my clients, and we've been very privileged to work with Graham and Jeffrey and all the team, Delso and everyone at The Wheel, and it's been a great journey. Hopefully that journey will continue in some way. We're still waiting to hear what the outcome of various negotiations and talks are. But at the moment, it's up and running, and you can go and enjoy 50-metre high views of the city.
And will it stay? Would you like it to stay in the city?
Of course, we'd love it to stay. Mm-hmm. I think it should stay. But
it was always understood that it would go, though, wasn't it?
Well, this understanding's a little bit vague. I think there's understandings, and then there's agreements, and neither have been really clarified. So at the moment, we're just looking at all the avenues to see whether The Wheel could exist, or whether something could exist, or a partnership could go, or maybe we can look at some time to decide. Mm-hmm. There's various options, but ultimately, I believe The Wheel should stay and cohabit with the other attractions in the city.
They should be able to work together, I would have
thought. There's absolutely no doubt. You've got the Sea Life Centre next to us, which is a fantastic partner, which we've worked with. Obviously, I run Brighton's Big Screen, and that cohabits beautifully with The Wheel.
That's the next thing we're going to talk about.
Okay, yeah.
But I understand Worthing, by the way, is after The Wheel.
I think there's been a few inquiries, as there would be with any media coverage. You'll get people seeing it on the telly or reading it and saying, do you know what, I fancy that. Mm-hmm. I think Worthing would be great. I think Worthing should have its own wheel. Whether it's this wheel or whether it's another wheel, we don't know. But I think Worthing would be a fantastic location for a wheel.
It's a really good idea when you think of it. Okay, let's talk now about the big screen. I mean, that's almost your baby, isn't it?
It has been, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, we started, just a few of us, debating what to do with the Olympics in 2012. And we missed out on a live site. The live sites were around, Locog decided where they were going to put these big screens around the country, and Brighton missed out. And as a result, we felt Brighton should have one, so I built one. We basically went 6 weeks before the Olympics, lobbied Locog very, very hard, and got permission 6 weeks before. It took us 6 months to actually get the permission, but 6 weeks before we got the permission, so we had to build it very quickly, and it started in 2012 down by where the I-360 is. Mm-hmm. Obviously, then the I-360 came along, and we had to move down to buy the Brighton Wheel. And it's been a phenomenal success. We've been delighted. This year, we've been joined by Mike Holland and some great entrepreneurial skill from him as well. And he's putting a lot of infrastructure help and support into it. And it's now become a permanent fixture for the summer. People absolutely crave and love it. We have huge amounts of social media traffic on it. This year, we're showing the UEFA football. We've just had that cleared with UEFA, and we've paid our dues, and we've secured the UEFA rights. So, we go from the 10th of June to the 10th of July.
So not just to show movies on, then?
We like to combine sport. I think sport's great because you've got that connectivity with sport. You've got that kind of, you can sit down and really, you can talk through sport as well, which is great. We can have up to 5,000 people come to the venue at any one time. When we start, there's actually three matches a day, so we're looking at turning 15,000 people a day capacity to come and watch. I think the second games we're showing is England, and we've got England on the 11th, Wales on the 12th. We've got four home nations competing, so of course there'll be a great support there. But it's funny enough, when we did the World Cup, the support when England went out, we thought, oh no. But actually, the excitement only ramped up because I discovered Brighton and Hove is unbelievably diverse, and we have such a lot of European and world support.
Of course.
It was amazing. Mm. It was just incredible. Suddenly, we came into this. We had Sky Sports. We even had Al Jazeera broadcasting live from our site. This year, we've got the same. Not so much with Al Jazeera or Sky Sports because it's you know, it's obviously filmed in France. But TV come and broadcast. We're hoping that latest TV come down and join us down there because, along with the football, and I think the weekend of the 24th and 25th of June, we've got the Wimbledon finals, we've got the British Grand Prix, and we've got quarterfinals from the world, from the European Championship.
So, have you forgotten you're in England?
Do you know, it's really weird, I know.
What I say about the weather is what my main thing for you.
Yeah.
You know, we're not really blessed with the best weather in the world.
Well, we still, even undercover, we've got a VIP grandstand, we've got VIP areas, a covered bar area. We can still accommodate 600-700 people undercover. And we do. The football's free, the movies are £3. So it's not a huge commitment, but it means that once you've paid your £3, or from £3, you can take a £7 grandstand seat, or you can take a £35 full VIP hospitality meals and drinks and everything to see. Mm-hmm. There's ways of going around it so we can work around the weather. But June and July are notoriously quite good.
So how many months are you up for?
We're up for a month. Mm-hmm. We come, like I say, we build from the 2nd of June, we start on the 10th, we break down from the 10th of July after showing the European finals. We have some mega blockbuster movies, and we've got some great things. We've joined up with Ibis, and Ibis have got a fantastic idea. They're launching a new bed on the beach, so you'll actually be able to lie on a double bed and watch a movie and have room service and kind of the whole thing that goes with it, a big VIP area for them. We've got some really good educational things. University of Brighton have come in with some shorts again. We work very closely with them, and the shorts are fantastic, really clever. And we had a huge food offer. So we're hoping to have a very large restaurant chain come and set up a restaurant. We also have Grubbs Burgers, are going to be serving Grubbs Burgers down there. We have My Slice Pizza. So there'll be a lovely kind of selection of food you can get
as well. Is 1 month worth it?
It's worth it in terms of the editorial content from the short films and give advertising. So we have advertising opportunities for sponsors and for commercial partners. That helps us massively. Mm-hmm. We run the bar, so hopefully some people come down and enjoy a drink. And the food element is fantastic, and it just encourages people to stay. You know, we show films like Pulp Fiction, and Pulp Fiction gets 3,000 people to come down. They've all paid £3, and they're happy to come and, you know, sit and have a drink or two. But we've got some mega blockbusters. Think of out-of-this-world blockbusters coming to the beach this summer. And they are, you know, so we've got some pretty big exclusives. And we do cult films. We're doing things like Rocky Horror and sort of, you know, Grease again and sort of Dirty Dancing. And there could even be a giant shark swimming around on the beach.
I've got a request someone wants to see The Martian, though. Is that
I possible? Think The Martian would be great, actually. But you've got to be careful with those films. We're about event, and we're about a kind of sense of party, fun. So things like Grease, everyone came down as pink ladies. If people look at the big screen website, it's fantastic. People dress up. So we want to encourage that. So we've got Priscilla sort of just coming before the actual screen, you know, before Pride on the 4th. So we want to make it a Pride screening. The Wizard of Oz. We've got the Wizard of Oz as well, because we do the doggy screenings. So we're showing Lady and the Tramp. So you can bring your little dog and you can come on the beach and sit.
So what happens to the screen for the other 11 months of the year? Is it your garage?
Yeah, I wish. We don't own the screen. We hire it in. There's no point in owning the screen because it's too much money. It's too much of an outlay. And also, screens evolve and change every year. So we have now an HD screen. This screen is 40 square metres. And we could actually potentially show 3D films on the beach. So it's the highest quality screen you could ever have. It's 40 square meters. We run Blu-ray and it is fantastic quality. So people are amazed that we put that much infrastructure. It's a massive cost to us, but I think it's worth it because we give people value.
I mean, many years ago I lived in Australia and I used to go to the drive-in movies quite a lot, but then it was projection.
Yeah, we've tried projection, but the trouble is we're mostly in the summer, so you're not getting kind of dark till 8-9 o'clock, and we run in the daytimes. And projections are notoriously difficult to see in the daytime, so we use the very latest LED, and it is fantastic.
Well, technology moves forward, doesn't it?
Well, this is it. You know what it's like.
So that's one of the little jobs you do.
Yeah.
Well, two of the little jobs is the wheel and the big screen. Brighton and Hove as a whole, I mean, you really are a Brighton man. And you've seen lots of changes over the years.
Massive. I mean, I'm delighted to be involved with the new King Alfred development as well. I lobby hard for them and work on their local press initiatives and public engagement. And that's been a real, that's been a pleasure to work with Rob Starr and his team. Certainly the Chris Nicholson input as well has been fantastic for us. So,
I've been to Rob earlier about the development, and he doesn't seem particularly hurt by some of the comment. But what about you? Do you think it's been unfair, some of the comments?
I think you can expect it. I think, with a development of this size and scale, people are going to kind of worry.
They're going to please everybody.
No, this is it. And we're, I noticed that we've engaged a lot over, no one else was standing on a freezing cold seafront 3 or 4 years ago, as me and Rob are doing, asking people vox pops. We've got them on our website. So we stood and we asked people what they wanted. This is before Crest. This was before, really, there was any competition. We knew there was something needed doing, and we knew, and I saw Rob's enthusiasm, that we could do it. So, it is a real David and Goliath kind of struggle.
And your enthusiasm helps as well. We're going to be back in a moment. Don't go away. I'm joined, of course, today by Bill Murray. I'll be back after the break. Don't go away. Back to The Vote with me, Mike Mendoza. My guest today is Bill Murray from Murray Media, the man who's been around town for the last 50 or 60 years, working like a little Trojan ears. Everywhere I go, you seem to be there.
Well, I tell you what, it's people like you that actually got me here, because you've supported me all the way through. You've always helped out. You've attended my events. You've connected me up with people, and you've been a great help. You've been you're an institution, Mike, and I think you've really been involved.
Someone said I should be in an institution.
You've had tendrils throughout a lot of things that we've done over the years, so it's great to be here, and it's great that people like you, Mike Holland, they're the bedrock of this city. And actually, the consultation process, when you talk about things like the King Alfred or even Big Screen for that matter, is born out of people who have built this city in the first place. I think you've helped build it. So there's a lot of things that we should be grateful for.
I mean, you have got a love for the city.
Totally.
And you're seeing the changes along the seafront, for example, the I-360 coming in. We had the wheel in, which you were involved in.
Yeah.
Sadly, that is going, whether we like it or not, according to the council anyway.
Yeah.
But we're talking about the council. I mean, again, you've seen a change of administration. Do you find the general feeling is different with this new council?
Oh, yeah, I think you're right. I think there's a change of feeling. I think there's a warmth that they're starting to bring in. Initially, obviously, it's bedding in and you've got tricky business kind of taking it. It's like, starting a new job. But I think Warren and the team have done a reasonable job so far in kind of, embedding themselves into the city. I certainly think the city has a huge opportunity in terms of its international appeal. And I think there's events that are going on that kind of create that. I think what the council did last year, and people like Ian Taylor at the council with the Olympics initially, and then obviously with the Rugby World Cup last year, what they did for that was fantastic.
It was amazing, wasn't it? Well,
how good did they do?
And put the spotlight on Brighton. Though.
That's it. Hats off to him and his team for doing that, and good old Pauline Freestone and people that really put that together well. So there's a real appetite for that part of the seafront as well as the city, and we want to, with the big screen, become an offer that doesn't just decline that part of the seafront but enhances it.
There is talk now of the Brighton Centre going and the Churchill Square moving down virtually to the seafront, and the whole centre moving towards Saltdean Way, towards the marina,
that's
I'm halfway
there.
Is that a good move, do you think?
I think you've got to weigh up, as we did 4 years ago, 5 years ago, and Rob was doing 5, 6 years ago with the King Alfred, is you've got to start talking to people. You can't make these decisions without engagement and consultation. And not just the formal consultation, you've got to get out there. I mean, we were hiring the King Alfred Ballroom 3 or 4 years ago for have meetings when it wasn't even kind of relevant to do the King Alfred. I think you've got to talk to people and find out what they want. I think, Brighton will only exist and prosper if its people are behind the development and the changes it makes.
A lot of local traders don't agree because they say the conference centre should be in the centre, and the position it's in at the moment is good because you come down from Queen's Road and you've got it right in the corner there, you've got hotels either side, but to move more towards the marina is out of the way.
It'd be a challenge, I think, to get people to kind of, cross-pollinate the city. But the marina infrastructure is looking much better. I think Andrew Goodall's doing a great job down there. And, for want of gusto and entrepreneurial spirit, he's got the entrepreneurial spirit. So I think you've got to be careful that you don't look at the city plan as being too segmented. I think the city plan needs to be all embracing. So transport and a rapid transport link, I think, needs to be considered.
Would you like to see a monorail system or some type of...
I back the monorail system for different reasons to everyone else. I just think it's... people will say it's ugly and takes the seafront. I actually quite like the fact that it's aesthetically pleasing. I think what happened in Seattle was fantastic with the monorail. So I think David Courtney and his team have done a great job so far. And obviously, it's up subject to the people again. You know, I mean, personally, I love trains. I used to run train conferences. So I love the idea of having a monorail. You know, I grew up at Butlins in Minehead. And so, you know, for me, that was a fantastic opportunity to go on a monorail.
Have you been to Vegas, by the way?
I haven't been to Vegas.
Oh, right. I mean, I didn't realise it, but around the virtually the back of all the strip there, there was a monorail system.
Is there really?
Which I didn't even realise, so went to another block up.
I'd love to go to Vegas. No, I haven't been yet, but it's on the wish list.
I expect to see you there.
I'll go with Lucky Mike.
But so we are seeing quite a bit of a regeneration of the seafront.
Totally.
What else would you like to see there?
I think there's outcries of all kinds. I think, you know, it's great that Soho House are, you know, potentially getting involved. And I think that network of restaurants around the terraces, that's a great opportunity. I think there needs to be more for younger children. I think, you know, there needs to be something. And the King Alfred's going to be fantastic, but it's got to be all-encompassing. And I think, you know, there's got to be... I've, you know, two young children in the city myself. Obviously, they're growing up now. But I think the engagement for families needs to be there. And we need to encourage... bigger leisure operators maybe to come and use the city. I think what Mike's doing with the engineering is fantastic, and that should be a genre setting development, and how he's done that is phenomenal. But I think, again, we need to enhance that. We need to support that and embrace, you know, what we've got here. And I do think bigger leisure operators should be more interested in the city than they are.
When you go out and about and you're dealing with various companies and you have to deal with the council, do you find different councils are more difficult to deal with than others?
There's different things. I've worked on big developments around the country. We had huge issues with one particular development where we had to halt the development because of a certain type of newt, and which cost millions and millions of pounds to preserve a newt. I think there's certain things that councils do right and wrong in every single city. And it's the same with media. You know, they'll pick up on the same stories and they'll pick up on the same... issues. You get the kind of same vibe with each big project that I've worked on, particularly with development, in that councils follow a certain line. There is a due diligence they have to follow, which is frustrating, but ultimately is what they have to follow.
Actually, I was amazed at the timescale for the King Alfred. It's going to take another, four or five years even?
Well, if you think,
before
we see
it up and running.
How long it took, you know, Terminal 5 at Heathrow, you know, you've got to think how long the Channel Tunnel took. You know, these are, you know, all right, they're vast developments and things. This is a vast development and it needs to be sympathetically handled. So I think in time it will show that there's been the proper due diligence paid and the development is what we want.
Is it over the top, though, the due diligence?
No, I don't. I think, you know, when you're talking about something that could last 200 years... Let's try and be gentle. Let's try and ease this in, because this is for my grandchildren, and this is, you know, and I think it's sort of, you know, looking for their children. So, you know, I really want to make this, you know, we've got one chance.
In your mind, is the design right?
I think the design is absolutely spot on at the moment. It's what...
And for the future?
What was worked out, and I think the future is what the public decide.
What's the feedback so far? I mean, what we've seen in the press is one side. We're not seeing that much positivity coming out.
I absolutely disagree. We've seen a few people that have talked about it being too solid and dependable. I think if that's...
That's a good thing, isn't it?
Well, absolutely. Mm. I mean, I can't imagine us coming in with something that was, you know, the Geary Towers were very iconic, but obviously it needs to be sustainable and deliverable. This needs to happen. We can't put unrealistic parameters on this. This needs to be something delivered for the city. And so if solid dependable is a start, if that's the bedrock, and we can do design changes, then we're in the right place.
But we are seeing other proposals at the moment for other very large blocks along the seafront.
Yeah. I think that's indicative of the appetite from people to live in Brighton.
And the old Sackville Hotel site, for example.
Yeah, that's an interesting site, and we'll have to gauge opinion on that. I think they're reaching out to the public at the moment and sort of, you know, doing the planning process.
But it's all down to cost, isn't it?
I think, yeah, I'm not too familiar with that scheme, but I think it is down to a kind of cost element, but also as well, it's down to the appetite of the residents.
I mean, when you look at the Astoria site in Brighton, which was, again,
which I love, yeah.
the proposal there was good,
yeah.
But in the eye of the council, it wasn't.
No, I mean, I think, you know, you've got to look at the case history of that site. I mean, I love that venue, and I think there's, but it's again sat
had
there.
Had to go.
Oh God, you know, it's ridiculous. So, and I think, you know, the same with the Hippodrome, and you know, and the campaign to kind of get behind that. I think that's a valid campaign to back. And,
but again, it's all down to money, surely.
Well, this is it. This is it.
It's and very it's easy to say, this is what we want, or the public come out and say, we've got to have this there, but who's going to pay for it?
This is it. Mm. You know, and everyone will complain about something. Well, let them take their money. And, you know, people talk about, you know, they want this and that. You have to do what, you know, kind of people like Rob's done. Rob Starr has basically put his money where his mouth is. He's gone out there and he's secured something for the city. And I think everyone's potential is to do the same.
As a matter of interest, what in your mind is affordable housing? Is it surely it's whatever someone can afford?
I think, yeah,
which
I mean,
some people can afford,
we've
but
got
others
so many
won't.
Different levels of shared housing. Now. I mean, I think shared housing is, you know, and the affordable element, I think, is certainly a way forward, and it will certainly help with the shortage that we have. But yeah, I mean, it's so varied now. You can house ownership has changed since, you know, certainly when I was out trying to scrape together a mortgage.
Which is why more and more people, I think, are moving out of the city towards, in fact, going west more than anything. Because I know when we moved to Shoreham Beach, for example, from Hove, and Shoreham Beach was very affordable then. Now it's in sort of the £1 million plus.
Unbelievable.
So people are now moving Worthing way.
Well, obviously, you were a big attraction, Mike. When they knew you were there, you had the groupies.
It probably helped,
yeah.
I'm sure.
It's, you know.
I'm to blame for the whole house.
The house boom, yeah. Mike Mendoza.
All
Mike Mendoza.
Like I've got to keep moving around the coast now. I'll be Little Hampton next week.
You can regenerate the entire South.
Well, you've got a lot of projects on.
Thank you, Mike.
And I wish you the very best of luck for that. And we're going to get you in and do some other stuff with this as well very soon.
Lovely. Thanks.
Look forward to the big screen. It starts when?
10th of June.
What's the first thing up?
We've got France playing. The first match is obviously the French game, with being the home nation, on the 10th of June at 7 o'clock. So, yeah.
Good luck.
Look forward to it.
Our guest today has been Bill Murray from Murray Media. We're back with another vote very soon.